Thank you so much, Susan, and all the comrades here for having me here. I'll just try and briefly talk about the situation in India. After China, probably India is, you know, one of the most talked about countries. You know, it's supposed to be the big success story. It's also being talked about as an Asian power. We have a prime minister now who's been, you know, in his election speeches kept talking about how India must compete with China now to take that place that, you know, China now occupies. So it's supposed to be an emerging Asian power and an IT superpower. We boast of one of the world's highest rates of growth in the number of dollar millionaires and dollar billionaires and so on. And at the same time, India is also home to the largest contingent of the planet's poor. We are now into two whole decades of the liberalization, globalization policies, which were first introduced in India in 1990. Just to give you a picture of the kind of what it means to be poor in India, is that we had a report sponsored by a government department that came out with a report that said that 77% of Indians spend less than rupees 20 a day. 50 rupees would be a dollar. So you can imagine that this is rupees 20 a day of spending by 77% of the population. India is still a country that is largely dependent on its agriculture. So you have 60% of people dependent on, for their subsistence and livelihood and so on agriculture. And yet this is the sector that has taken the worst kind of beating. It is the last priority for governments. And you have a situation where you have more than 200,000 farmers committing suicide since, I think, 1995 onwards. So you have this huge number, and it's a virtual epidemic of farmer suicides that nothing has stopped, nothing has quelled. And you have a situation where there is fertile agricultural land. What passes off for development in India now involves enormous grab of land, both of fertile farmland as well as of forest land for the minerals underneath it and so on. So you have this enormous grab of India's natural resources and human resources. Much of it obviously coming with not only loss of livelihood and eviction of the poor and of indigenous people, but also of tremendous environmental devastation with no regard to the consequences. So we have that happening. And you also have prices keep going up and up and up. They never come down. And so prices of absolutely essential things for people are continuously soaring. So these have become big issues, of course, for people. And in the last few years, we've been seeing a lot of public outrage also about these enormous scams that have been happening. And it isn't a coincidence that some of the largest corruption scandals have involved natural resources that ought to belong to all people. So they have involved minerals. They have involved 2G spectrum network. They have involved land. These are the clearly the policies that have opened up these natural resources for grab by Indian and multinational corporations has paved the way for these huge scams on a scale which used to be unimaginable previously. And the priorities of the government in this are quite clear. The priorities of governments that we have seen in the last couple of decades have all had similar priorities, the same priorities, and they have their budgets tend to be extremely pro-corporate budgets. So you have them handing out corporate subsidies to the tune of 25 lakh crore in tax breaks for the corporations, huge tax subsidies, and yet those don't get called subsidies. So the subsidies for the poor are actually completely chick feed compared to that. And you have, you do have some welfare measures in terms of food rationing, but there's been enormous cuts in all of that. So they've tried to say, we'll target the poor, we'll identify the poor, and we'll only give some kind of limited support to those poor. The point is that when you have 77% of the people who are poor, it would be better to target the rich and to identify them and sort of, you know, maybe exempt them from getting the food rations and so on. And now, of course, there's a move to move away from food rations into some kind of coupon system or some kind of cash handout, which obviously given the rising prices would not help at all. So this means that absolute essentials, even like food, are things which people don't have access to. Water and electrification are again things which the large majority of Indian people have no access to at all. Now this is the backdrop in which we've been seeing extremely important movements as well. One must remember that when one talks about Indian development, India also has boasted till a few years ago about a 10% double digit growth rate and so on. And while that has come down now, it's also true that it hasn't plummeted as much as it could have in given the crisis and all of that. So what is happening over there is that most of our growth is, you know, the engines of those growth are the service in service sector and real estate. Again, real estate involves enormous grab of land and so on. And the service sector is one of the most exploitative sectors. And you have, when you grab land and you rob people of, agricultural workers of their livelihood, you're having this huge influx of people in search of work who have either lost land or lost their work on the land. And there is really this enormous army of surplus labor which has nowhere to go. So you have an enormous amount of labor available for exploitation. And labor rights have taken an enormous beating. So we do have labor laws, but the labor laws are most of the time, although people have a legal right to organize at the workplace, that right is denied. And so if you do try to start a union, or if you if there is already a pliant union that is close to the ruling party, if you try to start an alternative union there, you're likely to lose your job. Labor laws like minimum wage laws, contract laws that restrict how many contract workers you can employ, all these laws are violated not only by corporations but even by the government sector on a very, very large scale. In the backdrop of this, we are seeing a variety of very powerful movements that have been happening, which are also having interesting political consequences. Some of those movements have been movements by peasantry against land grab in all over the country. And this has been seen in many, many parts of the country where peasants have been organizing to resist land grab, or indigenous people have been organizing to resist the grab of forest land and to assert their rights over forest land, over water resources and agricultural land. So these are very powerful movements. Of course, there is also equally really, really very harsh repression that we are seeing. And on February 21st last year, there was an All India strike, which a large number of the trade unions jointly, and that was an immensely successful and very, very powerful strike that was an that brought several sectors to a standstill for 2 days. It was a 2-day strike, February 21st and 22nd, and it was an extremely powerful strike last year. And of course, there was enormous repression on that as well, with workers being arrested and workers being kept in jail without charges for months on end under various of the draconian laws that India has. And you also have seen a very powerful movement against corruption. That is an interesting development in that, you know, the main sort of segment of that movement was represented by someone who did not have a particularly radical or progressive agenda. So most of the discussion around corruption centered around, in that movement, centered around the demand for a new, for an ombudsman, for an anti-corruption ombudsman, a Lokpal, which of course the ruling party tried to deny. This happened a couple of years back. How we responded to that, a lot of some of the left parties sort of felt that this anti-corruption upsurge need not be engaged with. It's a large movement, but it's essentially a middle class thing, or it's they had some conspiracy theories about it. But what we did, the CPIML Liberation, especially our student and youth wings, they mobilized very, very strongly in this movement, saying that this movement doesn't have to have just one brand. You can have a powerful mobilization to talk about the pro-corporate policies that are at the root of corruption, and to, you know, make those connections felt and talk about that. And we had an enormous, wonderful response to that. And on the back of that movement, now, there is a new party that has emerged called the Common Man Party. Aam Aadmi Party, the Common Man Party. So that's a party that has spoken to and touched a chord with many of the extremely poor people, as well as you know, youth, as well as people who are losing jobs and so on. And it has, so it does speak a certain kind of left language on some things, but when they have been asked to talk about their economic policy, they have, you know, made the classic Thatcherite kind of assertion about how the government has no business to be in business, and so on. So it's a party without, which hasn't really made up its mind about a whole lot of things, especially where it positions itself on economic and social policies. But my point is that, you know, the outcome of this entire crisis in which India finds itself, and above all, it's a crisis of democracy. So I'll just very briefly talk about, because I think there'll be time later when there's a Q&A as well about the Indian political situations. I won't go into details on that. I'll just end by saying that this is a crisis for Indian democracy, because we have a situation where the corporations actually seem to have made gained a huge amount of control, not only over our economic policies, but you know, over you know, over large parts of life as such. Just to give you a small instance of that, one of India's largest CEOs, the largest corporations, Mukesh Ambani, he's a big industrialist. There were some tapes that were released a couple of years back, which revealed corporate lobbyists as well as CEOs talking to, among other people, talking to politicians in the ruling party and the opposition party. So they were clearly controlling the ruling party, controlling what the opposition party says inside parliament. They were talking to media persons, so they had enormous, they were literally dictating to media, prominent media persons, what to write, what not to write, how to cover stories. They were talking to judges and so on and so forth. And this Mukesh Ambani was caught on tape talking about the then ruling party, the Congress, and saying the Congress is my grocery store, it's my shop, I can go in there and buy what I like. So yeah, and of course it is no coincidence now that the same Mukesh Ambani is one of the prime, and he owns 27 television channels in India, so he virtually owns all the media, he's our Murdoch. And he now is backing the man who is prime minister now. So he funded, probably he helped to fund this large image makeover for Narendra Modi, who's an extremely right-wing, somebody who has blood on his hands, the blood of innocent Muslims on his hands. And this is a man who is now India's prime minister. So the corporations helped fund his makeover. And so just very briefly, I just wanted to say that while we are, I mean, what Narendra Modi has called good times, he said, oh, good times are here now that I'm prime minister. We know that, well, times of protest are certainly good times. They're challenging times. They're good times. They're interesting times, in the Chinese phrase. But I think that, you know, the important thing is that this crisis does have several kinds of potential outcomes. Of course, the right-wing government that we now have is undoubtedly a huge challenge to the movements, and it has come with all sorts of promises about bringing down price rise, bringing down corruption, and creating jobs and so on and so forth. But it also has its corporate backers to pay off now, and it may, you know, so we will be intervening in this challenging situation. And but there are also other political currents, like this new party does reflect. Why I mentioned it is because it reflects the fact that people are actually looking for, seeking some kind of alternative to the main, you know, what in, to the Congress and to the BJP that is in power now. And there is a large section of Indians who is actually wanting to find a political representation that is not controlled by the corporations and so on. I won't go into details now about the left parties in the situation now. I think there'll be plenty of time for that later. I'll leave you there now. Thank you so much.